If Titanic wasn't designed poorly, maybe it was built poorly, and perhaps this contributed to the sinking. Titanic was owned and operated by the White Star Line, which was under pressure at the time due to their competitors, especially Cunard Line, which had great successes only a few years earlier with Lusitania and Mauritania. At the time of their launches, both Lusitania and Mauritania were the largest ships in the world. They were also both blue-ribboned winners, an accolade given to a passenger ship that had crossed the Atlantic Ocean with the highest average speed. Needless to say, this didn't sit well with White Star management. Titanic was built in Belfast, Ireland, by Harland and Wolff, who are still in business today. She was the second of three essentially identical sister ships, with Olympic being her predecessor. Construction began in early spring 1909 and completed approximately 3 years later. Working conditions in the shipyard were brutal, and it was very common for workers to be on their feet for an entire 9-hour shift in the middle of winter. 254 work-related incidents were recorded during the build, and 8 people died. The workforce was largely unskilled labor, with young men as ripe as the age of 13 working as riveters, which may be alarming, but it was normal for the time. In an average month during construction, it was reported that about 20% of the workers were unskilled laborers with no prior experience. Titanic was held together by about 3 million iron and steel rivets. The iron used to make these rivets was sourced from multiple locations all across the United Kingdom and thus varied in chemical composition. The bow and stern sections contained hand-hammered iron rivets, while the rest was done by a hydraulic riveter using steel rivets. Steel rivets, generally speaking, were better than iron rivets, even though they were roughly the same price in 1911. Harland and Wolff knew this, but steel rivets were also more difficult to drive in correctly by hand and were more prone to requiring rework, which slowed things down. The reason the bow and stern section were not hydraulically driven was due to space restrictions. Keep in mind, the primary area of impact with the iceberg thus would have contained hand-hammered iron rivets, which may have allowed the damage to be greater. At completion, Titanic was the largest ship ever built. It was about 100 feet longer than Mauritania and could accommodate about 1,000 more people. It was also very luxurious and magnificent in many ways, but in terms of technological advances construction-wise, it was pretty average. It had a steel structure as well as watertight compartments, which were common since the late 1800s. The innovative Marconi wireless communication system had been installed on a German ship a decade earlier. Its engines and propulsion system, although efficient, had also been used on previous White Star ships. The idea that this ship was technologically advanced and unsinkable, which drew enormous coverage from the press, was the result of brilliant marketing. The collision that Titanic had with the iceberg could be reasonably compared to the collision the BCM Atlantic had with sea ice. At the time of impact, the Titanic was traveling at a speed of over 22 knots. A shrimp trawler, the BCM Atlantic was only traveling 6 to 7 knots, less than a third of the speed of Titanic. The BCM Atlantic was made with more modern steel along with a welded instead of a riveted hull as in Titanic, which theoretically should make it more resistant to impact. The size and weight of the BCM Atlantic is also likely to be only 1 to 2% of that of Titanic. Between the speed at the time of impact and the differences in mass, the amount of energy that the BCM Atlantic had relative to Titanic was infinitesimal, resulting in a much smaller impact. In both cases, witnesses on board described the impacts as relatively minor or bumps, and believed the damage was insignificant until inspected. Unfortunately, they were wrong, and both ships sank in a few hours, despite knowing there was sea ice around. The key takeaway here is that the BCM Atlantic was a much smaller, more modern ship traveling at a very slow speed, yet the impact with ice was still plenty to sink the 180-foot boat. So, what is the significance of all of this? Not much, in my opinion. If you built Titanic with a modern, welded steel hull and modern manufacturing processes, but otherwise used the same design, and it struck the same iceberg in the same way, the passengers are still going to have a very unpleasant evening. Maybe the damage wouldn't be as extensive and the ship stays afloat longer, but the point is, the Titanic was built to the best standards based on what was known at the time. In the next video of this three-part series, I will discuss what I believe is the biggest culprit of the Titanic disaster. Thanks for watching.